Ah, superb. That was absolutely great fun. Hi, it's Dan Veall here, down in the Guitar Interactive basement once again. And we're looking back at an old classic today. This amplifier, you can't actually buy them brand new anymore. But you know what? When I was growing up and when I was getting into bass, this amplifier appeared on more stadium stages than I can possibly remember. All of my favorite bassists had one of these behind them at some point. So I thought, well, if I loved it, then I'm pretty sure that there's lots of other people who do too. And those who haven't seen one before, well, this is my opportunity to show you a little bit about how great this amplifier is. Well, what is it? It is the Ampeg SVT2 Pro. This thing, this is a monster. It weighs in, that's 70 pounds or 31 kilograms. This thing is actually heavier than I think any bass cabinet I presently own. Underneath this all-steel chassis is a 6655/50 valves for the power amp. We have 5 preamp valves and another 3 driver valves as well, bringing together an absolutely colossal sound. So much so that when I set up this rock tone for my introduction, I actually had to turn the amp all the way down because it was shaking the floor and potentially overdriving our microphones. So this thing is a beast. As I said at the start, this thing I have seen on, you know, stage footage at gigs for many, many years. And I really wanted to spend a bit of time just showing you why. As usual, we'll go through the controls and have a look at the front panel, and then later on we'll spin the amplifier around and can have a look at the goodies in the back, namely the valves. It's actually not an unusual layout in comparison to a lot of modern amplifiers, but what it does do, even if it is simple, is actually really effective. On the left-hand side, of course, we've got the standard input and a pad. So if you've got an instrument with a high output gain, you can pad that back a little bit. This particular bass is a 1976 Fender Precision with an ash body. And the pickups on this have actually got a reasonably low output. So I've left the pad out and I've turned the gain up a little bit so I can just drive the first preamp valve. Along from the gain control here, we have some EQ pre-shape controls, I suppose. Ultra low and ultra high. The ultra low we're going to listen to straight away, and that gives me some extra low end boost, but also cuts out some of the mid range to make it sound a little deeper. So this is what the control sounds like when it's not enabled. Ultra low enabled. Now already I had tons of low end coming from the amp. This is almost unnecessary. But if I was playing with a bass that had a particularly middly sound, this could help to just even things out a little bit. Now the ultra high that I mentioned earlier on is actually on the other side of the front panel, near the standby switch, which is over here. So I'm going to engage that now and we can hear a bit of top end sparkle. And immediately I think of a drive pedal. I want to stamp on that, have this in as well, and get a nice clicky, aggressive, sort of punky sound. I mean, you could almost imagine plugging in a Rickenbacker and getting that real good clanky sound out of the amplifier as well. That would be, well, just a beautiful thing, wouldn't it? Okay, so unfortunately we're going to go back over to the start of the front panel. Here we go. And underneath we've got a bright switch, which is a different frequency from the ultra high that we just mentioned. And that's going to add on a sort of more airy top end. So here comes the enable. This is great if you've got a muted sound bass and you want it to sound a little more active, a little bit more brilliant, I suppose. Here it comes. Really nice clank going on there. It's doing that precision bass thing for me, and I don't know why I just didn't enable that straight away. Let's move on. The next controls along, we have got drive, bass, mid-range, a frequency control, and then the treble control. This makes up our tone selection in the amplifier. I'm just going to dial out that bright switch quickly. And so we've got a drive control here. This is a rather awesome inclusion, actually. What this allows us to do is change the tonal structure of the preamp for when we start adding in distortion. Now what I've got to do is I'm going to have to dial the sound a little bit and then reset the master volume and then play again to give you an idea of going from, let's go straight from the sublime to the ridiculous. I mean, if we're going to do this, let's do it properly. So I'm now going to bring my master control up, and I should now have a slightly throaty distortion sound. Yeah, nice. It now sounds like it's 20 decibels louder. It's starting to really crank out some real aggressive bass sounds, but actually I've maintained a lower volume on stage. So I can get that nice driven sound. Of course, we can't push it as hard as I'd like in the studio where the power amp valves start working a bit harder because unfortunately, I don't think our cameras could take it. Anyway. What this allows me to do now is I can start dialing in more drive with the gain control. Now, I'm going to just guess. I'm not even going to bother checking this. I'm going to go straight in and see what it sounds like when we get this filthy. Sustained for days, and that is really disgusting. It's perfect, absolutely brilliant. Great fun. So we've got quite a lot of gain that we can mess around with. And of course, I haven't even dialed in the tone controls to soften the amount of brittle drive that we've got there. That's obviously for you to try, or otherwise we'd be here all day, wouldn't we? I'm gonna set the amp back to where it was, and then we shall continue. Okay, so moving on then. That's the drive section, and it's all valve. So we're getting some real valve distortion out of this. This is fantastic. Don't get me wrong, I love my digital processors. They are absolutely amazing. But there's something to behold about a little glass bottle making this much row. Let's move on. Okay then, so away from the drive control. Bass control here is centered around 40 hertz. And actually I've pushed it a little bit harder for this particular cabinet that we're using for the review. But there's a lot of gain to be had. So I can actually pull the low end away quite significantly, even by going towards the 12 o'clock position. But if you are listening on decent speakers, you'll notice that my bass still sounds really good. Sometimes you pull the bass control down out and the bottom falls out of your world, quite literally. I mean, it's all the guts from the instrument sound has gone. So thumbs up straight away, isn't it? I mean, I can pull that back a little bit and actually still maintain a nice punch to my low end. Lovely job. Okay, so let's move on. In the mid-range setting, another, I love this thank you for having this on board. If you've seen my other amplifier reviews, you'll sometimes hear me banging on about semi-parametric mid-range controls. The ability to choose a different frequency that I'm gonna act on. So if I'm finding I've got too many low mids and I'll back them off, yeah, I can do that. If I want some more upper mid-range punch, then I can do that. And the Ampeg SVT here, I can switch to one of five different positions. And I can't remember them, so I'm going to read them off my notes. Position number one, 220 hertz. Position number two, 450 hertz. Position number three, 800. Position number four, 1.6K. And then position number five is all the way up in the 3 kilohertz setting. So we've got some nice low mids, that lovely woody sound, up to maybe what I'd say was more pick attack, if you want to add a bit more brightness or sharpness to the tone there. I'm not going to go through every single setting. I'm going to take 220, 450, and 1.6. So 220 is the lowest, and I've actually pulled 220 out a little bit. Let's boost it up. So this is my previous setting. Okay, so let's push that up to around the 2 o'clock setting, round about there, and we'll have a listen to the difference. Loads of really nice low mids. I mean, if you're playing with two guitars, then this is really going to start supporting their low end and actually adding some extra weight to the overall sound. Really nice blend. 450, typically on maybe passive tone stack controls, around 500 hertz is where you kind of like get that natural scoop, I believe. So let's do that. I've taken the switch up to position number two, and I'm going to scoop out some mids. Here we go. Instantly, I think of a passive tone stack. It sounds like it to me. Really nice. And then I think I mentioned going up to the 1.6 setting. So for a bit of extra pick sparkle, I'm going to push up the gain. Let's have a little listen to that. Let's see what we've got going on. I really like that as well. I'm just dialing in sounds almost willy-nilly here, and I'm finding something that I really, really like the sound of, and it instantly reminds me of an amp or a song or something like that. And now I don't know which one I prefer. They're really, really cool. They all sound really musical. There's quite sweetness to this amplifier, I think. But anyway, I could talk about that all day. Let's move on. Finally, our treble control. Just a nice, well-balanced, not too harsh sounding top end. I can dial it all back and go finger style for something a little smoother. Or I can push it around a little bit and let's see what happens when I do a little bit of slap maybe. Yeah, again, I'm going for that low D every time. It sounds brilliant. But those cool little moves that come out and actually sound really, really sharp. Actually sounds really, really smooth in terms of overall volume as well. I don't know if that's the valves doing that or just my exceptional playing today. I don't know, but it just sounds really, really cool to me. Okay, let's move on. Master volume on the right-hand side. We talked about the ultra high earlier on. Underneath there, we have got a switch which enables us to turn a graphic equalizer on and off. I am not going to go through every setting here. You're going to have to take my word for it that actually this allows me to do some extra tonal shaping. It's foot switchable. So you know what? I could actually use it as a second channel. Maybe if I'm going from a finger style to a slap move or something like that, I can punch that button in. And what I've done today is I've just set it up for an overall EQ. So whilst I'm fiddling with everything down below here, I know that my bass line, if you excuse the pun, is this nice sound here where I've bumped the lows a little bit. And I've got a little bit of extra brightness on the treble frequencies as well. And on the right-hand side here, there is actually level control. So I can actually use it as just a flat boost. Finally, on the right-hand side over here, near the handle, we have got two nice big switches. One for standby, one for the mains power. On valve amplifiers, what this allows us to do is to put the amplifier almost to sleep, but to keep the valves warm. So each valve has got a heater inside of it, and that's required in order for the valve to work. What you don't want to do is keep switching those on and off. It's best to be able to leave the valves nice and warm. You know, if you're waiting for the support band to finish before you go on, then you can set everything up and get it all warmed up ready. But by switching the standby, it actually turns off everything else and just keeps the amplifier in a standby mode. And then finally, two nice big sturdy handles on the front, not only to protect all of the controls from bumps and scrapes and the like, but you're going to need these as well, because as I mentioned earlier, this thing weighs over 30 kilos. Now I'm going to flip the amp around. We're going to have a look at some of the connections on the back, and hopefully you'll get a little glance at the six power amp valves through the grille. Okay, so round the back of the amplifier, and you can see those six gorgeous power amp valves glowing away nicely. Absolutely superb. But do you know what? We're going to actually have a look at the rest of the connections. Now, as you can see here, as I said, I've left it plugged in. So we've got the power lead on the left-hand side. And I want to keep this very, very simple for the time being, because there's some things that you can refer to in the manual about setting up the amplifier in terms of biasing. So I don't want to worry too much about that. But moving on, across the right-hand side of the panel, we have a number of really useful connections. Now, the first one we can see as we come just past halfway is a slave output. This allows us to chain more SVT2s together should you really need to shake the foundations and play through several massive Ampeg bass cabinets. You may be aware of the fridge cabinets, which has got 8 10-inch speakers in them. Also very heavy, but they sound really, really cool. To the right of that, we have the ability to split up the preamplifier valve section and the power amp valve section using preamplifier out and power amplifier in. This means it's a little bit like slaving. I can send my preamp signal to another amplifier or recording desk or whatever it might be, or I can take the sound of a different amplifier preamp and actually use the power amp of the SVT. Brilliant if you like switching between different amplifier characteristics, for example, but don't want to carry around loads and loads of extra amplifiers. You can plug in different preamps instead. And to the right-hand side of that, we have got the DI output that we were using today, but I've unplugged it just so we can spin the amplifier around. This is for connecting to front of house or a recording device. We've got level control and the ability to pick off the signal from before the EQ or after the EQ. And then finally, to the right-hand side of that, we have got an effects loop, send and return, pretty typical fare on amplifiers these days. And then the tuner out. So even with the amplifier in a mute mode, we can still tune with an external tuner. And then to switch on the graphic equalizer, for example, we've got a foot switch jack. Okay, coming up from there, so I have to go up to about here now where this is plugged in. Okay. So coming up from there, finally, this is a nice inclusion. My first SVT2 didn't have this. This one does. We have 2 1/4 inch sockets wired in parallel. And also, as I said, this one has a speak on as well. So we've got this nice, big, hefty cable plugged in. And with valve amplifiers, you need to match the speaker impedance to the amplifier impedance output. So just underneath, you can see a little red switch there, which allows us to select either 4 ohm cabinets or 2 ohm cabinets, or however you're spitting your load there. So I've got the switch just in the 4 ohm position, and that's working fine for the cabinet that I'm using today, just for monitoring. So there we go. That is round the back panel of the SVT 2 Pro. I hope you've enjoyed my noodling and creating a bit of a racket with it. I love this amplifier. It's a bit back-breaking, to be honest, but it does sound absolutely fantastic, and I think recorded, it's going to be a real diamond in the studio. So there we go. Fantastic. This is the Ampeg SVT 2 Pro. Thanks for checking out the review, and hopefully I'll get to bring some more vintage amplifiers to Guitar Interactive for you to check out soon. Cheers, see you again.